Since the first human being walked upright to modern man, he has had an insatiable appetite for the superstitious and a fear of the unknown. History is filled with legends of wild beings, of creatures and monsters to feed man's sensation of fear. Nessie, the monster of Loch Ness, has underscored these emotions and stimulated man's curiosity with a fervor that knows no bounds. What you're about to witness is unique. For the first time, you will see the actual underwater film of a monster or whatever creature it is as it swims by our submerged motion picture camera. Whether it is a plesiosaurus from 100 million years ago or a modern underwater creature, science has yet to determine. For the first time, you will see man's attempt to break the barrier of fiction and come up with scientific proof that a monster or monsters do lurk in the muddy depths of Loch Ness. Every scientific means at man's command is being used today to lure the creature from its lair, from underwater signals created by a synthesizer to sonar, miniature submarines, and lone divers with powerful searchlights. The drive to establish once and for all the creature's existence has brought people from all over the world, and they are risking their lives daily for just such a fleeting glimpse of some huge form of sea life beneath the surface of Loch Ness. As man faces unknown dangers in his pursuit of a legend, he is hampered by the lack of physical evidence, other than testimony of sightings and a few distorted photographs. He's driven on by legends, stories of the monster dating back from the 12th century, by tales of mysterious happenings at the Loch, even fantasies of strange beings from outer space who might have implanted some new form of life on our planet. All this mystery urges him on to pursue his relentless search to satisfy his curiosity, to find something, anything at all, that will give an inkling, the slightest clue as to the monster's actual existence. We will, in this film, attempt to explain the basis and background of the legend and try to establish logical theories as to what the creature could be and how it might have come into the Loch. Interviews with people who have actually seen the monster will lend credence to its existence, and undisputed photographs will corroborate those sightings. But the proof, the actual motion picture film of a creature, may be the final answer to the legend of Loch Ness.
This is John Cobb, attempting a world speed record on the morning of his death. If Cobb knew the reason for the crash, it remains a mystery. And now the answer may be known only to the creatures living within the dark, cold silence of the loch. The town of Inverness on the northern end of the loch is part of the spiritual, as well as the geographic center of the Scottish Highlands. It is located in an area known as the Great Glen. And here, beneath the surface of these deceptively shining waters is one of the greatest and most elusive mysteries of the world. This is the home of the Loch Ness Monster. The loch is actually a narrow trench, a mile and a half across its widest point and some 22 miles in length. During the Great Ice Age, these highlands were covered with a layer of ice estimated to have been 4,000 feet thick. Slowly, huge glacial mountains of it began to slip, gouging steep valleys and lake beds in its path. And so Loch Ness was born. Urquhart Castle was destroyed by its own occupants during the 17th century to keep it from falling into enemy hands at the time of the Jacobite Rebellion. Far below its crumbling battlements and ghostly towers are the deep underwater caverns in which the monster is said to live. And records tell of prisoners in chains listening to sounds coming from beneath the dungeon stones. Stories about these caverns are centuries old. At one time, it was thought they were extended underground passages to the open sea. And it was through these twisting corridors the monsters came. Eventually, they grew too large ever to return and remained to haunt the loch in its perpetual gloom. But somewhere in that gloom is the answer. And each dive is like a corridor leading into it. It's ironic that the first sightings of the Loch Ness Monster should have been made by a saint. Ancient scriptures tell us that Saint Columba, the man who brought Christianity to Scotland, chastised the monster for having devoured a parishioner who chose to ignore a sermon. Perhaps this was meant simply as a moral tale, suited to the needs of a tempestuous 5th century. But isn't it curious that St. Columba chose to tell his story of the water monster, having it take place in what is now the famous Loch Ness? Today, 1,400 years later, the legend still lives, and priests at the Benedictine Abbey carry the traditions of St. Columba into the modern world.
Well, a few of the monks have seen it. I had the boys investigating this a year or two ago, and we found that about a third of the monks said they had seen it, and about a third of the villagers. I think if you went all around Loch Ness, you might find that a third of the people had seen it.
Most of the sightings of the monster have occurred along this road. The houses and farms through this countryside face out onto the loch. And as a matter of record, more than 4,000 sightings have been reported since the turn of the century. Alexander Campbell, a retired fish and game warden, has over 50 years' experience of living and working on the loch.
Yes, indeed. I saw it 18 times. The first year was 1934, and that was my best sighting, because I saw head, neck, huge hump, which I estimated 30 feet long.
In a way characteristic of a man whose work consists of assembling fact, Police Commissioner John Cameron speaks of his own experience.
But the impression I got was a huge sight. Now, I had been in most parts of the world, and Indian Ocean, Pacific Ocean, flown over quite an area of sea, and quite familiar with sharks, whales, and I've been a fisherman since I was 8, and I never saw anything in the water like it.
The first known photographs of the Loch Ness Monster were taken in the fall of 1933 by Dr. James Lee. The creature was seen swimming through the water with its head erect, displaying three distinct humps on its back. It dived suddenly when it heard a sound on the road. What followed was an epidemic of journalists, cameramen, amateur scientists crowding the shores of the loch. There was even a big game hunter, a Mr. A.L. Wetherill, who had the misfortune to discover and identify huge footprints which later proved to be a hoax. He had neglected to notice that the two prints he found were of the same left foot. Some people simply made their own monster. Whenever man discovers anything new, there's always been something in him that makes him want to put it into a box and take it home. The monster was no exception. Overnight, there were schemes to capture it and put it on tour with a troupe of circus acrobats and dancing girls in some sort of monster follies. By year's end, the carnival atmosphere had begun to dissipate, leaving a small core of dedicated minds. They came from the universities, the geographic societies, the camera clubs, and ladies' auxiliaries, all hoping to spot the legend. Then, in the spring of 1934, were taken the most astonishing photographs of the Loch Ness Monster the world had ever seen. News was flashed across Europe and around the globe. Here was unquestionable evidence. Summer brought the first major organized investigation. During this investigation, many special photographic techniques were developed because of the extreme weather conditions on the loch. It was extremely difficult for investigators to authenticate their findings because each new sighting and photograph was a single aspect of the animal. But none of them could describe it or show it in its entirety.
You know, we're not spending all this time and money trying to prove that there's a large unidentified species in Loch Ness. We know that. We've seen it, and we know it's here. What we are trying to do now is identify the species.
With the support of Sir Edward Mountain, the investigations took on a new legitimacy. Each morning, trucks and vans rolled expectantly out of the Highland fog to set stations up on both sides of the loch, all carrying the latest equipment.
I think the evidence myself, and I've been interested in this for 30 years, is so conclusive that it does exist, and so many people have seen it, that I would prefer to put it the other way round, and say that once your eyes have given you evidence of a large creature, You must then go and look for what it eats and try and study its habitat.
Fishermen know that to catch a big fish, it's necessary to lure them with smaller fish. This was the first attempt to troll the loch, and Captain Eustace Maxwell hoped that by lowering these baited nets, evidence would be found telling us what the Loch Ness monster has for dinner. Zoologists can estimate an animal's size and bone structure from its diet. Because of the many reputable sightings, it was decided that there was more than one monster. Perhaps a whole family of them. And if so, then it might be possible to recover skeletal remains. But drawing in the nets, this hope was soon lost. It would seem the loch never gives up its dead. Occasionally, archaeological discoveries are made from diggings along the shore.
Mr. Taylor, you've had a brief look at this now, about 5 minutes. What do you make of it?
Well, I think that this may well be a bone, a very large bone. And one's first impression is that this may be part of a femur of some large animal.
Now, what part's that? That's
the thigh bone. And certainly a very large object. I'm fairly certain that it is made of bone.
What makes you think that?
Well, the texture of the object, its weight, and the fact that if you look very carefully at it, you will see what appears to be bone canals running throughout the structure of the object. It has the typical appearance of bone from which the organic matter has dissolved over a period of time, leaving just the ash intact.
How old would you say it is?
It's impossible to say, but it could be very, very old indeed.
Could it be, do you think, part of any animal that might have lived in these waters?
It's certainly not a part of any animal that we know of in science today. It's much bigger than any piece coming from, say, a large mammal such as an elephant or rhinoceros.
Bigger than that?
But it's bigger than that, and if indeed this is a bone, then I would think that it comes from some animal, either that is not known to science, which is existing now, or perhaps some prehistoric animal which is not alive, but which once did exist on the Earth.
Although the shark is normally considered to be a marine animal, one that lives exclusively in salt water, there is at least one major exception, a South American lake shark, that has completely adapted itself to fresh water. The shark itself is one of the most successful animals in the long evolutionary journey. It has survived intact from its beginnings nearly 300 million years ago. Normally, the shark would not be considered as having anything to do at all with the legendary animal in Loch Ness. But because of its apparent ability to adapt itself to fresh water, and the fact that there is a type of shark known as a bull shark, which very closely resembles an eel with its long, tapered body and small head, scientists are reluctant to dismiss it entirely. The bull shark usually has a maximum length of 8 feet, although a few have been reported at nearly 25 feet. It is not particularly ferocious, though the behavior of sharks is never really predictable, and researchers are seldom anxious to spend much time in a tank with them. But it is the scientist's job to be absolute in his judgment as possible. And so the shark must be considered a candidate until positively proven otherwise.
Exposition Park in downtown Los Angeles, California. A far cry from the cold, eerie dampness of the home of the Loch Ness Monster in Scotland's mysterious Loch Ness. Nestled between the famous Los Angeles Memorial Coliseum and the University of Southern California is the Los Angeles Museum of Natural History. Home base for Dr. Robert Lavenberg, curator of the museum's huge ichthyology department. His extensive studies of sea creatures have taken him to the most remote parts of the world.
Dr. Lavenberg, in your personal opinion, is it at all possible that some kind of sea life could be what we have come to know as the Loch Ness Monster?
The possibility that life exists in the deep ocean that is not yet discovered is very possible. We don't have the gear or the facilities right now to look into all of the ocean to determine what lives there. The Loch Ness is just a small sea or a body of water that's been locked off, and if we could drain it, we could see what was there. So that our abilities to look into that body of water and say, yes, something occurs, or no, something does not occur, are really limited. So the possibility is that something could be there, we haven't found it yet, or it's all been a figment of our imagination.
Doctor, assuming that there is a living creature residing in the deep waters of Loch Ness, what would you say it could be?
That's a good question. I'm not really sure what could be there. There are some candidates. For instance, a large eel, one of the fish-like vertebrates, could be there and seen. It could be a type of marine mammal, and there have been some photographs published of one of the whales or dolphins that has been lying on the surface for some reason, holding up its fin, and this fin does look like some of the sightings that have been made of the supposed creature that lives in Loch Ness. There's also the possibility that it could be some large vertebrate or some large animal that none of us are aware of. There is that vague possibility because we just haven't seen it. But I think the logical candidates would be if something occurs there, something such as a large marine mammal, one that's been landlocked in the area, or another type of fish-like vertebrate that breathes, that removes oxygen from the water and stays hidden most of the time down in deep waters, and for some reason only comes to the surface on relatively few occasions, and it's been on those few occasions that a sighting has been made.
Would there be a way for an aquatic mammal, fish or reptile, or whatever we choose to call the life in the loch, to have migrated centuries ago through a subterranean cavern when small, and to have grown too large to regain access to the sea?
It's really quite difficult to tell the provenance of an animal, where it comes from, but it's possible, not impossible, that some type of animal some time ago has been or has invaded this area and subsequently been trapped in there by some movements of the earth or a landslide or something of this nature. The earth itself is constantly moving. The continents are slowly creeping around the globe in a slow drift. And we can detect that through earthquakes. And we can visually see that the earth is in the process of moving. And in approximately 3 years, all of the planets in the solar system are going to line up. And during this period, there may be quite a bit of activity, of earthquake activity. There may or there may not be. We just don't know what's going to happen. And these earthquakes could result in shifting land masses, and they could result in the movement of Earth so as to trap bodies of water and their included animals that they cannot get back into the major part of the ocean. The marine mammals have been on the Earth for a short time, speaking evolutionarily. They're one of our recent animals in the ocean, or one of the more recent animals. So they differ from something like the coelacanth, which has a long fossil history and has been here for millions of years. And we know that from finding their remains in the rocks of the Earth. But they went for a long period undetected. We didn't catch them, we didn't find them, and then all of a sudden in 1939, one was suddenly caught. Now, whether or not we can take something like this, the coelacanth, as a living fossil, and relate this in some way to Loch Ness, I don't know. This is an entirely different problem. The Loch Ness differs in that there have been sightings, there have been people that say there is something there. The coelacanth was a different story. It was preserved in the rock. We knew it existed. We knew it probably had become entirely fossil. But all of a sudden, it was found. So we had no hunches, no thoughts about it. It just turned up all of a sudden. And so that made us really, wow, here's something that just occurred, you know, that we thought was fossil a long time. So it made quite an important discovery to look at it, to see how its internal structures looked, how it was put together, because we didn't have this information. We had only the remains in rocks. Again, going back to Loch Ness, it's all word of mouth. It's all something people tell us. They all see something. But is it real? What is it? And we have no basis to go back and say, aha, it was a fossil. There is some record in the fossil. Or there is a record of skeletal remains in the fossil record. We don't have that. So it's a problem of enormous magnitude, a gulf that we have to bridge here. On one hand, we know that the oceans probably in deep waters contain animals we have yet to discover. There are things down there we just don't know exist. We have to go out and look for them. On the other hand, we have Loch Ness. We have what supposedly is an animal, and we can't put a tag on it. We cannot identify it. We couldn't tell you whether it was a fish, and we couldn't tell you whether it was a vertebrate. And there are people that will say there's nothing to it, that it is all reflection, it is all some type of abnormality during filming or sonic aberration, that if it were there, we would know about it. And since there's no way to really document the record, so you have on one hand that we don't know whether something exists or not. And we have, on the other hand, the discovery of things that we thought were long since gone. And putting them together may indicate that there might be something there.
Sightings are rare. And anything out of the ordinary is cause for great excitement.
Thunder! Thunder! Something black there. Oh, where? Where? By the White House, to the right of the White House. That's been moving. You can get it.
No.
Yes, it is.
Yes.
Yes. Wait. To the right. You see, it's still there. It's still there. It's moving. Moving to the left.
Oh, I've got it.
Have you got it?
Yes.
Well, shoot.
film companies were eager to make Nessie a star. But due to her reluctance to show up for rehearsals, they were forced to build their own. Producers had some difficulty in casting the picture because actors were not willing to appear next to such terrifying machinery. A local Boy Scout troop from the town of Inverness began an expedition of their own. Special merit badges were created for the event. Promoters were quick to ride the new wave of public interest, and there was a rush to get many company names associated with the events on the loch. Some companies even sponsored their own expeditions. It quickly became apparent that something had to be done to protect the ecology of Loch Ness and the monster itself. Someone announced a bounty on Nessie. Local constables had to keep a sharp eye out to prevent any mishaps. This is Tim Dinsdale, an English aeronautical engineer. The time is 1960. In Europe, the war had passed, leaving the monster in several years of relatively peaceful anonymity. Peaceful, that is, until a certain morning in April, when Mr. Dinsdale took pictures of it with a motion picture camera. The authenticity of this film has been absolutely established through analysis by the Joint Air Reconnaissance Intelligence Center of the Royal British Air Force. In addition, the footage was screened through a computer enhancement process developed by the United States Space Program, especially for use on the Moon and Mars expeditions. A growing list of sophisticated equipment began to assemble on the loch, as well as the inevitable practical jokes. The body of a sea cow was smuggled in and planted along the shore. A Birmingham musician, John Sly, wrote a special song to try to coax the great beast into poking its head out of the water. The monster did not appear, failing to respond to Bach, Beethoven, and the Beatles. It was obvious that a major new expedition ought to have official government sanction, and that the issue should be brought before the members of the House of Parliament. Such a move would then lend an air of reliability to the project. Norman Collins, a top British corporation executive, urged members of the business and scientific communities to join with him in soliciting financial and technical aid. It was necessary to abolish, once and for all, the image of the monster as a fantasy in a drunken fisherman's dream. At this time, a controversial storm shook the British Museum of Natural History. A feud developed among the museum's officers when a member with an international reputation was dismissed from his post because of his interest and support of the Loch Ness research teams.
I find it very hard to believe that it is an animal in the organic sense.
And if not a beast, what then?
And these occur all over the world, these juxtaposition between the great serpent and the sort of flying object. And the same occurred in China. It occurs in places like in Ireland. And the carvings are there, these sort of humps, and this flying object in front of them.
The last bear in the Highland Forest was shot sometime during the 1880s. Before then, they had been plentiful in the uplands, roaming freely through the woods, playing and fishing in the streams and along the shores of the many lochs.
Thank you.
Bears are excellent fishermen, and they've been known to catch as many as 25 salmon in a single hour. Investigators on Loch Ness have long asked the question, how is it possible for the monster to withstand the extreme temperatures at the bottom of the loch, where it apparently stays for most of the cold months? Some scientists feel that it is able to do this because it has the ability to partially hibernate, like the bear, and they are currently involved in research that is trying to find a link between diet and the hibernation process. They know that Loch Ness is full of salmon, which comes down from the mountain streams and rivers, and that there are several kinds of trout. If the diet of the Loch Ness monster is similar to that of bears, then researchers feel it may soon be possible to make certain tentative estimates. Through the magic of research, the investigators at Loch Ness will solve more than a single mystery. These bears, though they've been gone from Scotland nearly 100 years, may help show the way. One of the most persistent theories about the monster is that there is no monster at all. What is seen are simply the manifestations of the monsters within ourselves. No doubt, due to the particular quality of ever-changing light on the moody water and the sudden leap of waves under the wind, visual illusions sometimes occur. Occasionally, the water will look pleasant and serene. But experienced divers who have slipped beneath its sparkling waves can testify to the hazards of the dark, peach-shrouded currents. Underwater, there is enormous pressure on a man's body, and it limits the depths to which he can dive. For the Loch Ness Investigation Bureau, the submarine was an obvious next step. For several years, the Bureau had been making plans for obtaining the use of a submarine, and there was much excitement when it finally arrived. Strangely enough, the actual depth of the lock is mysteriously unknown. For years, it was thought to be roughly 700 feet deep. But a submarine using a depth-sounding device recently took a reading of 975 feet, suggesting the possibility of great holes in the floor of the lock. Previous dives had brought back reports of caverns, like huge cathedrals, near the castle. And there is speculation today that by exploring the entire 24 miles of the loch's floor, using specially built submarines with powerful strobe lights, an entry may be found into a subterranean world existing below the loch. Members of the Pisces submarine crew repeatedly brought up stories of exotically colored fishes and eels. And several times, the entire 2-ton submarine was simply swirled around like a bathtub toy as it rested on the bottom. Earlier, they'd been tracking a fast-moving object, only fleetingly visible in the ghostly streams of the lights. But each time they drew near, the object would flash away in a manner completely unlike any animal known to marine biologists. To quote one of the technicians, "We're convinced it was not a school of fish or anything like that. We just don't know what it was." The Pisces was also equipped with a hand or claw. There was still hope that some part of an animal's skeleton could be found on the bottom of the loch, and the claw was constructed to handle objects of tremendous size and weight.
Robert Love, an American electronics expert, personally undertook the responsibility of designing a sonar plan to work with the Loch Ness investigation team. Since the war, techniques were invented for detecting and tracking enemy submarines and floating underwater mines. Many of these same techniques were employed to hunt the monster. Sonar had a new target. Signals were sent out into the water by the submarines, which registered on the equipment on board the surface boat. These signals were then translated into a kind of silhouette. In this way, it was possible to tell how big the object was and how fast it was going. Much the same way a bat squeaks, then listens for the echo to find its way in the dark. A biological research center in the Bahamas reported certain types of octopus whose behavior suggested the creature in Loch Ness. An investigation team was sent to capture one of these types for study. There is enough evidence for biologists to state that octopus exist, that are so huge, two of them, side by side, would cover an entire football field. Although there are no known octopus that live in freshwater environments, it is possible that caverns may once have led to the sea. The creatures then may have been driven into the caverns by predators and eventually found their way to the loch. If any survived, they might slowly have adapted to the brackish water of the loch and begun a new life, safe from all natural enemies. So much is unknown about the Loch Ness Monster that scientists are literally working in the dark, and they must examine each new possibility, no matter how remote. Unlike the abominable snowman of the Himalayas and the notorious Bigfoot of the Pacific Northwest, the Loch Ness Monster has become an institution and is always a major part of not only local celebrations, but festivals throughout the British Isles. Some forms of tourism, however, stir up resentment on the part of the local people. As controversial as the legend may be, it is still part of Highland heritage. Over the years, one of the favorite explanations is that the monster is actually a seal or a sea lion. Sea lions make tremendous bursts of speed, possibly accounting for the long wakes that suddenly appear in the water. But tests have shown that the wakes made by sea lions are very different than those created by the monster. The sea lion might account for some of the evidence. But again, the reason this is completely unlikely is because sea lions always give birth on ice floes or on land. An occasional live water birth might occur, but survival would be very rare. If the Loch Ness monster were some kind of seal, then there would never have been a mystery in the first place, because sightings on land would be frequent and common. Quail. The largest mammals on Earth have been suggested as the real legend of the loch. Not only could they qualify in size, but when swimming in groups, their backs do resemble the multiple humps usually associated with a monster. But when whales surface from a long dive, they blow huge quantities of steam and water into the air, something the creature has never been known to do. The modern world does not believe in dragons and sea serpents, and so we laugh at them. Or does the answer take us back 250 million years? Wing Commander Basil Carey's wife, Freddie, first saw the monster when she was a small child. She's demonstrated a remarkable psychic affinity for water, its spirits, and its creatures.
I've done water dividing for two different firms of architects. Generally, I start with map dowsing. They give me a large-scale map of the area that I'm going to, and I can go over that with a pendulum and a non-magnetic pencil until I find out where the water is, and then I can take my stick then and go along, and I know where to go to look for the water. You see, it saves a lot of trouble.
When asked, could she help locate the monster?
Oh, yes. I've told them where to put their cameras and where the creatures are, and they've got photos. But the thing is that I know where they live anyway, roughly, because I've watched the locks so often that I know where the things live, and I know what their habits are, I know what they do. And so in any case, I am able to tell them where the things live, more or less, and what they do.
Some people stand at the water's edge each morning and evening for years and never catch a glimpse of the creature. Others have seen it many times. No one's luck is the same.
Once again, Dr. Lavenberg at the Los Angeles County Museum of Natural History.
Doctor, can you tell us about scientists' recent deep sea discoveries and how these sea animals have evolved? What can be told of their longevity, if anything, and from their continual existence in the sea?
Life in the sea basically has two forms. Those that float or swim, and those that live on or in the bottom. And since man has been around, he's walked the seashores and picked up forms of life so that we have a fairly good grasp of the types of life that occur near shore. However, out to sea and in deeper waters, these areas remain relatively unexplored. We're just beginning to do the explorations of them, so that it is in the deep sea, in deeper waters, that the archaic animals are found. Those animals that have a long history of life on Earth. And it's fair to point out here that if we took one group, such as the mollusk, the clams and the snails and all of their allies, there's a pretty good indication that these have slowly, over long periods of time, invaded the deep sea from shallow waters.
Doctor, what species of sea animals have existed from prehistoric times
and are still found to exist today.
As a species, rather than an individual, probably the best known fish that would fit this category is the coelacanth. It has been around, preserved in the rocks, for more than 150 million years. And we knew about this fish as one of the archaic fishes that was instrumental in the colonization of land through a swamp-like habitat to become a vertebrate. And we thought they were long since dead, that they had become extinct. But in 1939, there was one caught by a commercial fisherman, and he saved that fish and got it to a museum, and it resulted in the spectacular discovery of a living coelacanth.
Can we assume that there is more than one creature in the loch, which could account for over 4,000 sightings over the years?
If you assume there are animals living in the loch, yes, then it's logical to assume that there is more than one. However, it should be considered that there might be relatively few animals, if they do exist, and the sightings could be of a very few. And if this is a locked area that the animals cannot escape, if they indeed occur there, and there are few of them, perhaps they have a reproductive method that ensures continuation of them for long periods of time, such as they may have internal fertilization and produce few young and have no real predators. There's nothing in there that is going to kill them.
It takes an uncommon stamina to endure the long waiting. Frank Searle knows what it's like.
I'm not here to prove that there's something in Loch Ness. I'm here to identify what is in Loch Ness. We have 1,400 years of acceptable written records to tell us that there's something in Loch Ness. For the first 5.5 years, I lived in a tent on the loch side, spent almost every hour of daylight out in a small boat. I've clocked up now 22,000 hours of watching, 15,000 hours of it from a small boat.
But the trek into the unknown requires more than sacrifice. One must be ready for luck when it comes.
It's very difficult to get pictures because you only see these animals for a short time. Perhaps 7 or 8 seconds would be the average sighting. So you realize that you've got to have a camera in your hand all the time, ready to go. Use a camera like a gun. This is why so few people get pictures.
None of these photographs have been retouched. The original negatives have been examined by the finest scientific laboratories in Europe and the United States. You are seeing only what is here, just as Frank Searle saw it through the camera lens. A few see in the monster a more pervasive evil. This is Dr. Ormond, an eminent clergyman and renowned exorcist.
I adjure thee, thou ancient serpent, by the judge of quick and dead, by him who made thee in the world, that thou look thyself no more in manifestations of prehistoric demons.
The words ring like an echo from St. Columba's day.
Begone, thou hideous demon, unto thine appointed place, and return no more to plague the servants of Almighty God.
And with the courage of Shakespeare's ancient kings, the minister defies the wind and who knows what unearthly creation. Another mystery of Loch Ness, the infamous Boleskine House.
Ah! Interesting ghosts, or whatever you want to call it, that inhabit the place is one of a chap called Simon Lord Lovett, who was chief of the Fraser clan at the time of the Jacobite Rebellion in, or whatever it was, the Battle of Culloden anyway, which most people will have heard about. He was finally beheaded for treason in London, in the Tower of London, and his head at the time of his execution was supposed to have fallen into a basket. And in fact, didn't. It rolled off across the floor. And the story goes that at the time of his death, that he was thinking of himself in the heart of the Highlands, which we are just about in the geographical dead center of the Highlands right here. And his head still rolls up and down the corridor outside this room here. And can be heard at night. I've heard it myself several times.
Mr. Crowley, by his own preference, liked to be called the Great Beast. Looking out over the grounds of Boleskine House, past the graveyard, one cannot help but wonder if he saw himself as a kind of alter ego to that great beast under the black water. In his strange life, might he not have communed with the monster itself, as he claimed to do so often with the raised souls of the dead hovering over the silent stones of the ancient crypts? Chicago. Perhaps the city that might answer those who have waited anxiously through the years to solve the great mystery. The atomic age began here, at the university, creating a terrible light more brilliant than a thousand suns. But it brought with it more than the technology of destruction. It brought the power to heal, and an even greater gift, the ability of man to probe the darkness among the stars and the secrets beneath the deep oceans. Professor Roy Mackel is a major scientist in his field, and is recognized internationally. For over 20 years, he's conducted research at the Biology Center at the University of Chicago. A new approach. A hydrophonically triggered sonar plate has been developed, enabling a submarine to track the monster without first disturbing it with the intense strobe lights used in normal camera operations. pre-expedition trial was to be conducted at an undisclosed location. And a new factor had entered the scene. Time. In order for the experiment to work, it was necessary to begin before bad weather hit the lock. Winter was coming to the Highlands. Sound carries surprisingly great distances underwater. To avoid startling the monster with noise, a series of visual signals was devised with a small electronic float placed over the area of operations. In coordination with the divers, technicians scouted instrument locations on land, stringing more than 2.5 miles of cable and generator wire. Special devices were inserted in the regulators on the divers' air tanks to muffle the sounds of the bubbles. Total silence was the key to this operation. The monster had been known to dive suddenly at the slightest noise. Sensitive plate was put in position so that it would not be accidentally set off by the submarine, which was to hover nearby. It had taken more than 2 years to develop an electric motor capable of operating the submarine quietly enough for this experiment. The question was, would the great bulk of the monster gliding through the water create enough vibration to be picked up by the underwater microphones? If so, it would trigger the signal to the sonar crew and alert the submarine. There was only one way to find out. The expedition was ready now to go down into the actual waters of Loch Ness. What kind of an animal will they find? Will it be some new creature, one that man has never seen? Or will it be something that has managed to evolve unchanged since the dawn of history? A creature from the dinosaur age that time forgot?
Thank you.
We know for a fact that creatures long thought to be extinct do exist today virtually unchanged since the age of the great reptiles, 250 million years ago. Beginning life from an egg no larger than that of an English sparrow, the monitor lizard of the Indonesian islands grows to an average length of 10 feet. They weigh upwards of 200 pounds, easily overpowering their prey, which consists of anything from small rodents to wild pigs and sheep. The environment in which an animal lives is cut off from the intrusion of other forms or more dominant animals. Then it becomes a sanctuary, a kind of harbor out of reach of evolutionary storms. Thus, on an island, for example, or in a stable body of water, they can remain indefinitely, adapting over slow centuries to minor changes in climate and food supplies. Distracted from its afternoon search for food, the lizard is wary when it detects the scent of man and lumbers off into the island brush. But the most dominant animal of all is man himself. Despite his relatively small size and vulnerable body, his brain makes him master, and he becomes the unnatural enemy. The prehistoric brain, however, is tiny, operating on a simple hunger-fear principle. And that is why the animals are so difficult to find. They are dangerous and unpredictable, reflecting the time of their primeval ancestors. When they are hungry, they are no longer fearful, becoming instead ferocious and intrepid. Hours spent stalking through the hot island sun can be rewarded with nothing at all, or the sudden rush of a hissing 200-pound reptile capable of encircling a grown man's waist with his powerful jaws. carnivorous habits of the dinosaurs must have been terrifying, especially among creatures 30 and 40 feet long. They were animals literally designed for killing, equipped with special horns and claws and teeth for tearing. Even the sky had its own unique terror. The instinct for the hunt was an essential aspect of prehistoric life. Without it, no creature survives. The predator is a beast within a beast, alive still, eating in the blood of a savage kingdom.
Due to the unlocated bottom of Loch Ness, it's back to the drawing board. A means must be devised to get scientists down to the depths, as yet unfathomable, to the modern undersea craft, a method for him to live deep beneath the surface for extended periods of study. Underwater science will, of necessity, be forced to borrow from outer space technology or from the blueprints of oil and gas companies continually searching for the new deep sea devices in their never-ending energy exploration. Or maybe we will find the futuristic drawings of popular mechanics magazines and the tales of science fiction writers not too far-fetched, or even better yet, we might draw from the master of them all, Jules Verne. Many adventurous companies all over the world see an abundance of mineral, energy, and food sources hidden deep in the ocean. And they are actually constructing great depth underwater craft to free these vital needs of the world from the bottom of the sea and relieve the pressure of land crops trying to feed the millions of hungry people in the world today. New substances are being discovered, stronger than existing methods, which will aid in equalizing the tremendous pressure exerted on the hull of an underwater machine in the deepest parts of the ocean. New breathing apparatus is in the experimental stages. All scientists' technology will be called upon to find ways of searching into the unknown deep ocean crevices of this new frontier. It is this mass of information, of trial and error, of experimental frustration that will someday bring forth the necessary technology that will enable scientists to unlock the secrets of the floor, if there is one, of Loch Ness, and locate the lair of Nessie, if she really does exist. Dr. Lavenberg continues his discussion of the evolution of sea animals to terrestrial beings.
We're pretty well convinced that life originated in the aquatic medium, in the sea. Through the millions of years, the Earth has been, or the terrestrial parts of Earth, have been leached, and the salts and materials have drained off in the ocean. So when life originated, it probably was fresher water than that occurs today. Less salts were in it. As life evolved in the ocean, it became more complex, and then in this sequence of evolutionary events, some of the animals that had formed, like the coelacanth, began to move into shallow waters or swamp-like areas, and they were able to survive in that habitat, and that was the very beginnings of the terrestrial form of life. These animals were able to invade a hostile environment. And one of the major changes had to be that in terms of the egg. In the aquatic medium, the egg is surrounded with water and doesn't desiccate. But on land, it could dry up. So that these animals at first were in a medium, in this watery medium, and tied to it in terms of reproduction for that, keeping the egg moist so that it didn't die. And one of the major jumps then to get into the terrestrial environment was to have an egg that was protected from drying up. And once this happened, this really enabled the animals to invade and colonize the terrestrial habitat.
Doctor, no one has ever unearthed any hard evidence of the monster of the Loch ever having killed anyone or hauled an animal back into the Loch. If Nessie is a benign creature or family of creatures, does that lead to any conclusion that it could be from the fish family rather than from the reptile or other species of mammal that have been known to have attacked men and ships?
I would not be willing to put it in any category on the basis that there hasn't been any aggressive behavior on the part of this animal or this image that has been seen in this area. It might be that if it exists, it is a filter feeder. It feeds upon the tiny organisms that swim or float in the water. Or if it is something like an eel-like organism, it could eat the fish, or it could eat on plant material. It could be a grazer. So it might not be a predatory animal. And if it's not predatory, there would be no basis for seeing aggressive behavior.
What known sea life could be categorized as possible monsters? The stories have come down for centuries of attacks on ships and men by mammoth sea creatures.
There are some candidates in the fish world, types of fishes, that might qualify for the status of monster. But this is a name that we would apply on the basis of man and his sightings at sea. If you'll consider some of the early days of the mariners out on the ocean, they were sloshing through the seas on these boats heavily laden with sails, and all they saw for days on end were the ocean, the blues and the grays. What if, alongside of their boat, a fish that was twice the size of the vessel suddenly appeared? And what if it were not the colors that they were seeing? It would make a very strong impression upon them. And there are such fishes. There are fishes that we call the ribbon fishes, and one of these is the oarfish. They are reported to reach lengths of 35 feet. They are a foot and a half to 2 feet deep, and they look like a ribbon. They are bluish silver with scarlet crimson fins. And the fins, they're modified in the front part of the head in these fishes to be 2 or 3 feet in length. They're scarlet red. And if one of these fishes suddenly appeared at the surface, right alongside your vessel, and erected this scarlet crimson dorsal fin, you'd be impressed. You'd be startled. And you would think, at first, what is this? It's so thin, and it might just disappear immediately. And with that short glimpse, with the brilliant colors, with the strange shape, some of these fishermen would go back and write these stories. And they would turn to the ship, and they would probably be afraid. And if you can imagine then, if there were relatively few people that saw it, and they embellished upon the story for whatever reason, then the myth that there is some large unidentified animal in the sea grows. And the larger it is, probably the faster it grows, and always is equated that it is going to harm man, or it's there to do some harm, and this helps build the image that they were afraid and it thrashed at the boat or something of this nature. Therefore, these fishes, the ribbon fishes, are really logical candidates to serve as the fishes that are depicted in some of our early books and literature on sea monsters.
And maybe Loch Ness is a mirror looking back over the shoulder of time. Unexpectedly early storm, which delayed the expedition for 3 days and nights, the divers and technicians were anxious to get out into the water. The submarine, which had been moored to a concrete anchor placed in the steep side of the lock by a previous expedition, sustained only slight damage to its rudder assembly. But crew members were confident it was not serious enough to cause further delay. Divers were sent down to help position the submarine and to explore the water conditions in Urquhart Bay. This bay had a history of being a favorite spot, and the monster had been seen here many times. They went deeper, moving through the dreamy water toward the caverns. Seconds ticked slowly by. The big question on everyone's mind was, had the storm made the monster restless? If it had, then there was a good chance it would be active and hopefully trip the sonar device. Peering into the cavern entrances, divers strained for a sign of movement. A water plant uprooted or torn. Anything unusual. Anything at all. Suddenly, a shore technician picked up a short, rasping sound. Coming from one of the underwater microphones, it came again. Louder this time. Guided by sonar from above, the submarine slipped through the water toward the target. Aquatic animal five times as big as the submarine, gliding through the water, propelling itself with huge flipper-like appendages. This is the first known motion picture film of its kind. And so we have come closer than man has ever been before. There is every reason to expect that the answer is very near. But when the phantom of Loch Ness is finally known, some part of it will remain a mystery forever, buried deep within the heart of the Scottish Highlands.